Kia ora and welcome to this week's Q&A Business Podcast, and I'm joined by Dann Laufer, who is the Associate Professor at Victoria University. He specialises in marketing. He's written for the Wall Street Journal and others. His specialty is around crisis management and contagion of crisis. Fascinating stuff. Plenty of interesting examples too to talk about from New Zealand. Dann, it is great to have you with us here.
Well, thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you for joining us.
For management people in business, is this a new area that they have to start thinking about, that even if they're operating in their little lane, doing everything they're supposed to be doing, they could be blindsided from another company that has poorer standards, and they have to have, what, systems ready to deal with that?
Oh, definitely. Definitely. They have to be prepared. You know, when a crisis hits a competitor, the initial reaction would be of perhaps delight to a certain extent, because they might view it as a competitive advantage. But really what they need to think about is, could we be linked to this? What are we doing in order to prevent that from happening? And increasingly, I think companies, I hope at least, are thinking along those lines. Because in terms of how people think and perceive the news, and these are based on, you know, concepts from psychology. So when you hear about a company in the news experiencing a certain crisis, the reaction isn't just, okay, the focus is on that company. People think about other similar entities. Now, here I'm talking about industry, but there are other factors as well. Country of origin. So with the Volkswagen crisis, the emissions crisis, what about other German companies? Not only about other automakers, but are there issues around ethics with companies from particular countries? So there are a number of factors that can cause people to link a crisis with another company. Industry is one, but
and are we seeing this, that those links being magnified by social media, by the media landscape, just the way in which things spread so quickly?
Oh, definitely. You can see it through social media and what's called chatter on social media.
Because you can't control it, really, can you?
Right. You can't control it, but you can monitor it. You can monitor it and you can influence it. You can't control it, but you can see the dialogue about the brand. You can see whether the brand is brought into the crisis. And then there are certain things a company can do through communications or actions that they take where they can influence the dialogue. But you're absolutely right. They can't control it. It's, the stakeholders, and here my focus is on customers because I'm a marketing professor, but you can monitor it and also influence it to a certain extent.
So for example, if there is a crisis raging and you talk about a brand, mm-hmm. if you were monitoring social media and you noticed that your brand was being dragged into it, even though you weren't mm-hmm. guilty, mm-hmm. Would you activate a strategy to get into social media and push back against that? What would be?
Definitely. You would issue a statement, and the statement would go on social media, also to the mainstream media, communicating that the company is not related to the crisis, and the reason there's a difference between your company and the company experiencing the crisis. I'll give you a concrete example. From actually the U.S., which I'm sure a lot of people in New Zealand are very familiar with, and that's that infamous case of the passenger dragged out of the plane on United Airlines. So here, it's not just United Airlines that people are thinking about. They're thinking about Delta. They're thinking about other American airlines, because the issue of overbooking in the United States is an industry issue. So in terms of crisis contagion, here there's a high risk of crisis contagion. Now, what did Delta Airlines do? Delta Airlines issued a statement saying, we have a different system in place, so this could never happen. And what's that system? The system is people bid on volunteering. So the airline asks them, if they see their flight is overbooked, how much are you willing to accept in order to go on a later flight? And so because of that, a passenger can't be dragged off the plane on a Delta Airlines flight, because it would never get to that. Before people board, the issue would be resolved. So you can see in that case, how a company can react. And in terms of the communications, it would be through social media and also through the mainstream media. And it really helped Delta a lot, because not only did people not associate the crisis with them, they suddenly thought, wow, this is a really clever way of dealing with the issue. So to a certain extent, it was a competitive edge. Yeah, it was an opportunity.
There was another case I think you've written about, the shooter in Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That must have been very difficult for that company in the hotel industry. How has Las Vegas dealt with that?
Well, you could see the CEO of the casino went on air and talked about it, and talked about how his casino, this was a competing casino, deals with security. And, you know, the interesting thing there is that, okay, this is specific to Las Vegas, but if you have a company, another casino, let's say in Macau, that issues a statement, and this, you know, relates to the risk of issuing a statement when you shouldn't issue a statement. If, let's say, a casino in Macau issues a statement about security, and no one is suspecting it,
right,
people would suspect something. They would think, wait a second, I never thought there's an issue, but if they're issuing a statement, there must be something here. So that's why when you ask about the monitoring, and we talk about this in the article, it's very important not only to assess the risk based on the framework that we write in the article, but also it's important to monitor social media and the mainstream media to see whether you're dragged into the conversation. And obviously a casino in Macau isn't going to be dragged into the conversation about a shooting in Las Vegas. So in terms of what they did in Las Vegas and the reaction of the CEO to the crisis, that was a proper response, because the issue was security in casinos that enable a shooter to go in and people not to notice. So
there will be, you know, there'll be there's sometimes a suspicion from the public, isn't there, about crisis management, about PR, marketing, that companies, if they've got nothing to hide, then why do they need it? What, you know, isn't it just a case of being upfront and honest, and then what's the problem? I mean, has it evolved, or is that still a sense you get?
It has evolved. A couple of years ago, I wrote an article about the importance of business schools offering courses on crisis management. And over the years, more universities are offering courses on that topic. You have to understand, I guess, from an organizational standpoint, if you're working in a company, you get praised for bringing in new clients, exceeding profit targets. But in terms of crisis management, you don't hear a lot about crisis prevention. No one gets a prize for preventing a crisis because no one hears about it. So from an organizational standpoint, you're not really rewarded.
It has to be an ethical base, though, doesn't it? I mean, it has to
aligned
definitely with an ethical sort of a... Surely if a company has a solid ethical or cultural values that it's sort of outlined, then it will be in a better position to deal with those crises, won't it?
Oh, I agree. Yeah, definitely. There's actually two types of crises that occur. It's not just the crisis itself. So in the case of United, the dragging of the passenger was the first crisis. But the second crisis is how the company handles the crisis, which makes things a lot of times even worse. And you're absolutely right. In many cases, if you're up front and you say, this is what happened, we apologize, end of story, because there's not much more to talk about.
It's interesting that case, though, because the CEO got involved.
Yes.
So that raises another question about when does a CEO get involved, mm-hmm, and what role can they play?
Yeah, so in terms of the CEO involvement, it's a complex issue, and there are a number of things that need to be considered. The first is the capability of the CEO as a communicator. There are certain people who are more effective in communicating than others. And so CEOs can be excellent at things like coming up with new products that are successful. Not everyone is a great communicator, so that needs to be factored in. There shouldn't be like an automatic, okay, this is a major crisis, go to the CEO, he'll be the spokesperson.
And Fonterra certainly learned that lesson over the years, didn't they?
Yeah.
Because the people they put up wasn't always the right one.
Yeah, yeah, that's one. The second thing is the nature of the crisis. So if a crisis is very severe, then there is an expectation that top-level officials will be speaking, and of course the CEO being one of them. However, if the crisis is not that severe, if the CEO is the spokesperson, you run the risk of drawing attention to something. And a really important aspect of crisis management is getting back to normal. And so if you're highlighting something, that's counterproductive. So that's another type of assessment that needs to be made. And then the last one relates to the audience. And this is very relevant in a global context. And we've conducted some research on this, and also it relates to Fonterra. And to a certain extent, it was inspired by what happened to Fonterra. So the CEO at the time went to China, and there was some discussion about that here in New Zealand. And it really intrigued us because it really raises the issue of, are certain audiences more influenced positively by someone like the CEO compared to others? Now, China is a very high power distance society. So the role of hierarchy, status is very important. And so when you have the leader of a company going there and communicating, that can influence how people perceive the message. Now, in a place like New Zealand, which is very egalitarian, status does not play as big of a role as a place like China. It's less important. There, it's the message. So we conducted research on that, and we found support for it. So in terms of what Fonterra did, at least from the standpoint of the audience, it made sense to send the CEO to China, as opposed to having him stay here in New Zealand and communicate to the local market.
Just finally, I mean, do you see lessons for government in this, or is it less of an issue, when you talk about contagion risk to countries, and New Zealand wouldn't be immune? Are there any things that you see from in terms of the way the government deals with crises, or is that a different field?
No, actually the concepts are similar. A lot of the concepts come from psychology, and also crisis contagion has relevance to the government. And I'll give you a concrete example from New Zealand, the water contamination and district councils, Hastings. And so other district councils need to be very concerned about this in terms of crisis contagion, because one factor is organizational type. And so people see what's happening in one district council, and they start asking, wait a second, what about my district council? And so actually there are very important lessons that can be learned in terms of how the government needs to react at the local level, in that the district councils need to assess the extent of crisis contagion. So in the report about the crisis with the water contamination, it was a combination of issues relating to maintenance and actually faulty equipment. And so the other district councils have to assess their situation. And if, for instance, the equipment is new and the maintenance is top-notch, they have to track social media and the mainstream media to see whether the discussion is around district councils. And if it is, they have to consider issuing a statement of denial. It doesn't have to necessarily be denial, because similar with the case of sexual harassment, you always have to leave up the opportunity, you know, the possibility. But you can talk about a much lower likelihood of occurrence and an explanation why. And so in that case, maintenance is different from the other district council, or the equipment is different, or the facilities are newer, something along those lines.
What about accountability, and in terms of being seen to be accountable? If there is a clear case of failing, of fault, of blame for something, how important is it for a company to show that the person at fault is being held accountable?
It's important. I mean, you know, one of the things I talk about when I talk about crisis management and teach the course is people always raise the issue of blame in a crisis. Who's accountable? And so companies need to be upfront about that issue, because it doesn't go away. And another way of thinking about it is when there's closure and you know the public knows what happens, everyone moves on. If there's uncertainty, or if someone isn't upfront, then the issue is raised again. And so an important objective of crisis management is to have the crisis go away. And how do you manage that? You provide closure, you provide an explanation to the extent you have the answer. I mean, when you talk about accountability, you don't always know sure. in a crisis. Malaysian Air is a great example. We have no idea why the plane crashed. I mean, there are a lot of, there's a lot of speculation about, which is very harmful. The speculation is a lot worse than knowing. Even if it's the company's fault, at least you can take action. If you don't know, then that's very scary from the standpoint of the public, because the uncertainty really drives a lot of people to choose other options.
Sure.
So it's in the best interest for the company, if they know what the cause is, to be upfront. And of course, if it's them, to apologize and move on.
Well, thanks very much to my guest, Dann Laufer from Victoria University, for his comments there on crisis contagion and crisis management. Fascinating stuff. That's it for this week's Q&A Business Podcast. Remember, we are on this Sunday morning Q&A. It's our last Sunday morning before moving to Sunday nights on the 29th of July. So keep that in mind. Otherwise, we'll see you again next week for the Q&A Business Podcast. Cheers.